Hello, and welcome to our question and answer session on data protection in AWS Cloud. My name is Harry Maliyu. I'm a senior technical program manager in the worldwide public sector security team. As a team, we work to identify and remove security compliance related blockers to cloud adoption for public sector customers. With me today is Nika. Nika, will you introduce yourself for our audience?
Hello, my name is Nika Lippert. I'm a security and compliance strategist at AWS in the EMEA region with focus on the UK. My job is to explain security and compliance at AWS, making it better understandable for our customers. These sessions serve not only your clients, but also assist regulators in understanding the capabilities of cloud customers.
Awesome. During our talk today, we're going to discuss the most common questions we hear from customers and attempt to answer them in simple language. Why simple language, I hear you ask? That's because it concerns legal aspects, and we are not lawyers.
And no, this is not legal advice. We're simply going to summarize publicly available information and provide context. You as customers will still need to evaluate the information. Naturally, we will provide links to the sources of information afterwards.
In this video, we'll be doing a role play. I'll be providing the role of a public sector customer operating in Germany and asking the questions, whilst Nika will use her subject matter knowledge as an AWS security strategist to answer the questions. So, let's get started. My data protection officer says that it's not permissible to use the services of a US hyperscaler or its European subsidiaries. I'm sure this is a question that AWS hears a lot. What is the answer for customers?
Indeed, this is a question we hear often. All AWS services can be used in accordance with applicable data protection laws, especially the General Data Protection Regulation, the GDPR. This was also the case after the so-called Schrems II ruling. Since mid-July 2023, following the introduction of appropriate guarantees by the American government, there's also again an adequacy decision between the USA and the EU, clearly confirming that the transfer of personal data to the USA is permissible. The adequacy decision provides both public and private organizations with a simpler and legally secure way to transfer data between Europe and the USA. Consequently, the use of cloud services offered within Europe by US companies is also compliant with the law. Due to this adequacy decision, customers do not necessarily have to resort to the standard contractual clauses as before, following the Schrems II ruling. For customers still wishing to do so because they want to cover data transfers to other third countries apart from the USA, the adequacy decision also provides a remedy for the so-called transfer impact assessment. Here, due to the introduced guarantees, customers can come to a positive assessment of the level of protection in the USA. So, to summarize, or in short, the answer is yes. It has always been and it is permissible to use a US hyperscaler and its services. One just needs appropriate legal transfer mechanism, such as the adequacy decision or guarantees that the data of Europeans in the USA will be treated adequately. And such guarantees exist. Apart from the already existing technical and organizational measures, which are relevant in a transfer impact assessment since July 2023, at the latest. Either way, customer, even before the Schrems II ruling, for example, even if no transfer was envisaged or might occur, already had to ensure that only authorized personnel could access personal data in plain text, so with that readable data, and it was and remains necessary to take suitable measures on a risk-based approach to comply with the General Data Protection Regulation.
Really interesting, Nika, and I think that much of this is likely to be new information for some of our customers. Our company's data protection officer will be pleased that there's finally clarity regarding the legal transfer mechanism, but they'll probably have some follow-up questions. What are these suitable measures and safeguards that you've mentioned?
It is about controlling who, how, where, and for what purpose accesses this protected information. Encryption combined with access control is one such measurement. Of course, the cloud services must support these, just as the processing location must be known to cloud customers, allowing them to control the storage and processing location autonomously. These and other criteria are audited for compliance by independent third parties. For example, in the Code of Conduct of the Cloud Infrastructure Service Providers, the CISP. Cloud customers can rely on this audit result. The Federal Commission for Data Protection and Freedom of Information has included a position communicated by the European Data Protection Authority in its activity report for the year 2022. Specifically, it writes about the guidelines on approved certifications and codes of conduct as instrument for third country transfers, stating that the confirmation of certification based on codes of conduct, such as the CISP, provides customers with suitable guarantees under the GDPR. As of May 2024, AWS has certified 107 AWS services according to the CISP Code of Conduct.
I understand. As a customer, it's my responsibility to use the services correctly. It's AWS's responsibility to offer the services in a manner that provide me with choices and flexibility. For example, I have the choice of how to encrypt my data. And by looking on AWS Artifact for details around specific attestations and certifications, such as the C5 certification, then I should be able to provide the desired detail to both my security organization and data protection officer. But then, why is there still a degree of skepticism towards US hyperscaler services?
Well, this dates back a long way and is partly due to the 2x loss of the legal transfer basis due to the Schrems 1 and Schrems 2 decisions. Following the Schrems 2 decision, data protection authorities issued guidance that additional safeguards must be implemented alongside the standard contractual clauses to be effective. These safeguards must be established by the responsible party, so with that, cloud customers and not by the cloud provider. For example, customers must encrypt with keys they control, not with keys controlled by the cloud provider. While the keys can be applied in the provider's cloud or the encryption services of the cloud provider can be used, the cloud provider must not have access to them and use customer keys themselves. Additionally, providers like AWS use specifically Hardnet Hardware Security Models, HSM, which are subject to a FIPS 140 to level 3 certification, ensuring that a cloud provider cannot access customer keys stored in such an HSM, neither logically nor physically. The way your customers use AWS services, data transfer not only to the USA can be excluded by your customer.
Okay, thanks, Nika. I have the detail that I'm looking for in data transfers, and I consider this element resolved. But what about support cases? Or if AWS receives a court order requesting information for criminal investigation purposes? Those are the concerns I'm asked about by our legal department.
My first recommendation is always to make support requests on the testing environment where synthetic data resides. In general, with AWS, all support personnel does not have access to customer data by default, when, for example, maintenance is performed on a cloud service. However, if customers explicitly request our assistance by opening a support ticket, they also directly control which information they provide. So for example, the data they manually insert into the support ticket or the content they show via screen sharing. Furthermore, only screen contents are securely transported over questions. So only a few lines of an entire database are transmitted, thereby excluding targeted searches by AWS staff. And if customers then encrypt the data, for example, in simple storage, with your customer key, then the S3 service team member can help them at the bit and byte level, but does not see the data in plain text. And regarding the question about a court order, that is indeed a relevant aspect. The laws of the country in which the provider offers its services apply, whether the Federal Criminal Police Office, Interpol, or a police action in the USA for the investigation of a crime obtains a court order. And if there are mutual legal assistance treaties or the Budapest Convention, which is a multilateral agreement on the search and seizure of computer data, then a service provider is subject to such requests and must process them. However, this does not mean that the information must be disclosed directly. No, because AWS cannot access a specifically requested dataset in such a way. And if it's encrypted, only the encrypted data would be provided at most. Because the Cloud Act, which is frequently cited as clarifying use of data act, does not specifically relate to cloud computing, it regulates so that neither indiscriminate nor bulk data collection can be demanded. Nor does it require the service provider to decrypt data or provide technical assistance for decryption. Therefore, the Cloud Act is described as encryption neutral. These points are derived from the fact sheet of the Cloud Act from the US Department of Justice. And as final point, the European Commission and the US Department of Justice have been working since 2019 on a bilateral agreement on the Cloud Act, with the result that the USA can only request data from US citizens in Europe, and the European member states can only request data concerning the citizens located in the USA, and each time only if there's a binding court order.
Great detail, Nika. So if I recall correctly, AWS assures me in the supplementary addendum that you will contest law enforcement requests for customer data from agencies inside or outside the EEA. If the request is overly broad, or if there's reasonable grounds for it, for example, if the request contradicts EU law. But how often does this actually happen? I need more detail and data for a risk assessment.
This is a very important aspect, the assessment of the actual risk. We publish these numbers you're looking for twice a year in our information request report. We differentiate between our e-commerce and cloud divisions. In the second half of 2023, Amazon, excluding AWS, received about 27,000 requests related to activities on the selling platform, nearly half of which were from Germany. During the same period, AWS received about 1,500 inquiries concerning customer activities on the AWS cloud, of which about a fifth originated from Europe. We clearly have both a team and a process in place to handle these inquiries. This is also verified in the C5 certification.
1,500 across the whole of AWS doesn't sound like much over 6 months. But still, for me in Europe, it's a risk that cannot be ignored. Can the data also be better defined regionally or at a country level? How many data sets were actually released?
The report contains more details, so please be sure to download and to read it. Regarding the question of the about 1,000 inquiries, approximately 1.5% actually were where customer data was requested, which is a relatively stable value over the past years. In most cases, account information such as billing addresses was requested. And as for your question about the regions, as to whether the 1.5% also involved requests for data from the European Economic Area, we can be more explicit and answer the following question. How many requests resulted in the disclosure to the US government of enterprise or government content data located outside the United States? The answer is straightforward: none.
I see. I understand this represents a theoretical risk. Thus, I should address it not only through technical protection measures, such as encryption, but also try and mitigate it. However, the risk remains. And it's incredibly helpful to have data points together to assess the likelihood of the occurrence. Thank you very much for the information and the links to the sources from which you've obtained your data. These are official positions of the supervisory authorities, which are certainly helpful to build a logical augmentation chain. In a previous conversation, you had pointed out that AWS cannot conduct a transfer impact assessment for its services on a customer's behalf, as these assessments contain actual details held by the customer, which is key. With what I've heard today and the technical data protection concept that we as a team are currently writing, we are now confident that we can achieve GDPR compliance.
You're very welcome. And if you need any further support in the future, whether with your own company data protection officer or that of the federal state where you're located, or even with a strategic customer, we are happy to assist here as well and provide comprehensive materials that we can share with customers.
That's very helpful, Nika. I must ask one more question while I've got you here. Are we the first customer to deal with these sort of compliance regulations and laws that use AWS services for public sector or the healthcare sector? Not that it should make a difference, but it's always reassuring to know what's possible. Do you have any references, use cases, or examples that you can give me?
Of course, I understand perfectly. And yes, we have several convincing cases where this approach has worked extremely well. Here are some examples in Germany. First of all, health data on ABS, one of the most sensitive data classes. The Fachklinikum Mainschleife in Frankfurt has its PACS and SIS system on AWS. So think about a complete digital patient record as the scope. Then, the Baumer Insurance, with the approval of the Federal Office for Social Security, stores a machine learning solution on AWS. And finally, e-learning in Schleswig-Holstein and Baden-Württemberg is also on AWS, and many more. So you see, it's possible. You as a customer just need to be prepared, do your work properly, and document it.
That brings us to the end of our question and answer roleplay on data protection in AWS Cloud. We hope you found it useful and that it will set you up for success when navigating security and compliance in the cloud. Many thanks to Nika, our security strategist, for sharing all of her expertise. For more information on everything we've discussed today, please have a look on our website and in the links provided below. Thank you.